Welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Bryan Lynn.
And I'm Katie Weaver. This program is aimed at English learners. So we speak slowly, and we use words and phrases especially written for people learning English.
Coming up, a report from Andrew Smith on drought conditions in the Amazon. Later, Katie and Mario Ritter Jr. bring you the education report. And we close the show with the lesson of the day. But first, a California wildlife organization says it has been rescuing sick sea lions in recent weeks, showing signs of algae poisoning. On August 1st, the Santa Barbara-based Channel Islands Marine and Wildlife Institute said teams had rescued at least 23 animals. The U.S. Vandenberg Space Force Base recently released photos on social media of sea lions being taken from one of its beaches. The Institute said that since July 26th, it had received numerous reports daily of sick lions along a 250-kilometer stretch of coastline in Santa Barbara and Ventura counties. The group said in a statement the sea creatures were found to be suffering from the effects of domoic acid, a poison that can harm the brain and heart. The release of the acid in a large ocean event is known as an algae bloom. The poison is produced by microscopic algae eaten by shellfish or small fish. Those shellfish or fish are often then eaten by sea lions, dolphins, or birds. The algae can also sicken humans. Among the signs of sickness experienced by affected sea lions are unusual head movements, disorientation, foaming at the mouth, and seizures. In a message published on Facebook August 4th, the Institute said the poisoning event was heating up, with new cases of sick sea lions still appearing at multiple beaches. It explained that rescue teams first tried to get the animals in a net so they can be transported for treatment and then returned to the sea. The U.S. National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration, NOAA, says poisoning events linked to domoic acid are common along the California coast. Experts said the latest poisoning event seems to mostly be affecting adult female sea lions. Last year, an especially severe poisoning event killed hundreds of sea lions and a number of dolphins during the first weeks of June.
The Amazon basin is facing one of the most severe droughts in recent years. The Amazon Cooperation Treaty Organization, or ACTO, said, "As the dry season begins in August, many of its rivers are already at very low levels, and several South American countries are preparing to deal with increasing forest fires, water shortages, and higher food prices. In several rivers in the southwestern Amazon, water levels are the lowest on record for this time of year. August and September are usually the driest months. That is also when most fires happen. The ACTO says the most affected countries so far this year are Bolivia, Peru, and Brazil. Recently, Brazil's Federal Water Agency declared a water shortage in two major basins, Madeira and Purus. Together, they cover an area nearly the size of Mexico. And in Brazil's Acre state, the drought has already caused water shortages in the city of Rio Branco. In June, neighboring Amazonas state declared a water shortage in 20 of its communities. The declared shortages came more than 2 months earlier than last year, when most of the Amazon basin suffered its worst drought on record. The 2023 drought isolated people who depend on water for transportation. Smoke from forest fires made the air in cities unhealthy to breathe, and high water temperatures killed more than 100 river dolphins. The Madeira River is one of the largest rivers in the basin. It is also an important waterway for soybeans and fuel. The river's level dropped below 3 meters near Porto Velho on July 20th. In 2023, that happened nearly a month later, on August 15th. The low water level means fewer boats could travel the river at night. And two of Brazil's largest hydroelectric plants may halt production, as happened last year. In the Amazonas town of Envira, nearby rivers have become too shallow to travel by boat. Local officials have asked old people and pregnant women to move from communities by the river to the city center. This is because medical help may not be able to reach them. The low water is also affecting food prices. Farmers who produce cassava flour cannot get it to market. As a result, this important Amazon food has more than doubled in price, local government says. Another worry is fire. There were around 25,000 fires from January until late July, the highest number for this period in almost 20 years. In the Amazon, fires are mostly human-made. People use the fires to manage fields and clear areas where trees have been cut down. Drought is not the only weather event affecting areas in Brazil's Acre state. Severe flooding hit 19 of the state's 22 communities last year. It's been 2 years in a row of extreme events, said Julie Macias, Acre's Secretary of Environment. She added, "The result is that we are facing a threat of food shortage. First, the crops were flooded, and now the planting period is very dry." The Amazon is the world's largest river system, carrying 20% of the world's river water into the oceans each year. I'm Andrew Smith.
A measure begun 40 years ago by South Dakota lawmakers and state higher education leaders has turned a small rural college into one of the top high-tech universities in the United States. It began at a time when the future of Dakota State College itself was in question. In 1984, the South Dakota Board of Regents, which oversees the school, was under pressure to cut its budget. It closed one college and turned it into a prison. Soon after, a new law went into effect. The measure put technology at the center of all Dakota State's study programs. The decision to reinvent a teacher's college founded in 1881 in a rural city of 6,000 people seemed risky. But at around the same time, Citibank, a major financial services company, decided to headquarter its credit card business in Sioux Falls, a city near the college. Jose Marie Griffiths is the current president of Dakota State University, or DSU. The school changed its name from college to university in 1989. Griffiths said Citibank was looking for computer programmers, and somebody came up with the idea that, well, we could turn this college that's fumbling a little bit into a computer school with software development and engineering. Griffiths told South Dakota Newswatch, "That way, we could supply the needed programmers to the Sioux Falls workforce for Citibank and ultimately for others."
Lynette Molstadt-Gorder was teaching at DSU 40 years ago when the change to a high-tech campus began. She said, at first, some members of the college community were unsure about the change and its effect on people and programs. Later on, we looked upon it as a welcome opportunity, she said. It was kind of hazy at first, and then all of a sudden, it just clicked. Suddenly, computers replaced pens, pencils, and typewriters in classrooms. And later, the move into computer science, and then cybersecurity, she said. The jump into technology at DSU started with a bachelor's degree in computer science using teaching materials from IBM. The teaching of computer science and software development, along with industry partnership, laid the groundwork for what was to come, Griffiths said. With a mix of private and public money, the university expanded the school and its offerings. In 2004, the National Security Agency named DSU a Center of Academic Excellence in Computer Security, one of the first in the nation. The number of students has also risen steadily from 867 in 1985 to 3,509 in 2023. The university said DSU now offers 44 degrees, including 7 master's degrees and 4 doctoral programs. In 2017, DSU started Madison Cyber Labs with money from the state and local businesses. It expanded research at the university to include cybersecurity, machine learning, and artificial intelligence, among others. The school is now planning an expansion into Sioux Falls itself. The plan includes partnerships with another research center and a Cyber Academy program for high school students. DSU is also pushing the state for more money to start a new center for quantum computing.
Jen Easterly is director of the Federal Cybersecurity and Infrastructure Security Agency. She was the lead speaker at a DSU cybersecurity event last March. Easterly said that before she visited Madison, she had been hearing increasing discussion on the national level about the growth and innovation taking place at DSU. She said, "The ideas generated at forums like this are just further proof that it doesn't matter the size of the university." Alexis Calm graduated from DSU in December of 2022. She studied cyber operations there. The 23-year-old said she liked the small-town feel of the college. She took classes in web and network design, computer programming, and malware analysis. All of them, she said, helped prepare her for the cyber workplace. "You get a strong, real-world education in your classes," Colm said. Colm also said she had several job offers after graduating. She chose Sanford Health, a company in Sioux Falls. It has a partnership with the university to increase employment opportunities for DSU graduates. Colm is not the only DSU graduate to stay in South Dakota. John Waldman and Chad Knutson were in the class of 2006. Soon after graduating, they set up a business together right in Madison. Their 90-employee company, SBS Cybersecurity, serves the banking industry in 49 states. Waldman said DSU has a commitment to innovation that makes it easy for students to remain on top of the always changing cyber technology and security industry. I'm Katie Weaver.
And I'm Mario Ritter Jr.
VOA Learning English has launched a new program for children. It is called Let's Learn English with Anna. The new course aims to teach children American English through asking and answering questions and experiencing fun situations. For more information, visit our website, learningenglish.voanews.com.
That music means it's time for the lesson of the day on the Learning English podcast. My name is Andrew Smith, and I'm joined by Dr. Jill Robbins. Hi, Jill.
Hi, Andrew.
Today, we bring you a special lesson. We're going to go back and revisit some fun moments from our previous podcast lessons. And hopefully we'll add something fun or funny to today's lesson.
Our lessons of the day have been based on our video series, Let's Learn English. The series shows Anna Matteo in her work and life in Washington, D.C. Here's Anna introducing herself.
Hello, my name is Anna Matteo.
The series has two levels, named Level 1 and Level 2. Level 1 has 50 episodes, and Level 2 has 30 episodes. That's 80 in total. And we have a podcast lesson of the day for almost every one of them.
But don't worry, we won't revisit 80 lessons today. We wouldn't want our listeners to get bored.
No, but they might like to hear this chant we did about the difference between the two adjectives, bored and boring.
Let's hear it.
Who's bored?
I'm bored.
You're bored.
He's bored.
She's bored.
They're bored.
In fact, we're all bored.
Guess who's boring?
I'm not boring.
You're not boring.
She's not boring.
They're not boring.
And we're not boring.
I guess that means that nobody's boring.
But I'm bored.
You're boring?
No, I said I'm bored.
Well, then let's learn with VOA. They're not boring.
All right.
Jill, that was a fun chant you made. I'll bet it kept our listeners interested.
I hope so. We don't want to be boring.
No, we don't. But you know what? A little boredom is okay. Sometimes we just need to rest and do nothing.
My cat is very good at that.
I thought it was kind of fun to talk about the words bored and boring in that chant we did. And some days I wish I could be a cat and just lie around and have someone feed me.
Me too. But speaking of the verb wish, we also gave some examples of this verb when we talked about Lesson 10 from Level 1 of the Let's Learn English series. Let's go back and listen.
I can't swim.
I wish I could swim.
I don't understand the question.
I wish I understood the question.
My head hurts.
I wish my head didn't hurt.
Jill, I hope your head doesn't hurt now.
No, it doesn't. At least not yet. I was just giving an example of how to say a sentence with the verb wish. You were the one who said your head hurt.
Yes, that's what I said. You have told our listeners the truth.
Well, at least now they know whose head was hurting.
Wait, whose head was hurting?
Yours.
Oh, yeah. Well, it feels fine now. But speaking of the word whose, spelled W-H-O-S-E, we also did a chant to help give examples of this word and of possessive pronouns.
Whose idea was that?
It was mine.
Oh, yeah, that's right. It was yours. This is the chant you recorded with your friend Jennifer, right?
That's right.
Well, let's hear it.
Whose is this?
Whose is that?
It's his.
It's hers.
It's theirs.
It's mine.
Whose are these?
Whose are those?
They're his.
They're hers.
They're ours.
They're mine.
Is it ours?
Is it his?
Is it hers?
Is it theirs?
It's not his.
And it's not hers.
And it's not ours.
And it's not theirs.
I think it's mine.
I think it's mine.
It's mine.
It's mine.
It's mine.
It's mine.
Is everything yours?
Not everything's mine.
This one's yours.
And that one's hers.
And those are his.
But what about these?
These are mine.
But what about those?
Those are mine.
Are you gonna share?
Of course I'll share.
Whenever we share.
It's not just yours.
It's not just mine.
It's yours and mine.
It's yours and mine.
It's yours and mine.
It's yours and mine.
And together it's ours.
And listeners, remember that Let's Learn English lesson plans are not just ours. They're also yours, too, and they're free. Each episode of the series comes with a lesson plan you can download. Simply go to our website at learningenglish.voanews.com.
And this is a good time to tell our listeners about another video series we have made here at VOA Learning English. And this series even has Anna's name in the title.
That's right. This series is called Let's Learn English with Anna. It has English lessons made for children and has lots of fun and creative ideas in it.
For example, there is Max, who is a mailbox that talks with Anna. And there is also Daisy, a flower that talks.
And just like the Let's Learn English series, Let's Learn English with Anna has a lot of humor or funny situations.
One way to be funny is to just change your voice. And Anna knows lots of other ways to be funny. So we've invited her to join us to talk a bit more about the children's video series. Hi, Anna. Welcome to the podcast.
Hello, Andrew. Hello, Jill. Glad to be here.
And we're glad you're here, too. Anna, can you tell us a few special things about the children's show?
Of course. The children's show is available in many languages, and I love it that kids in different parts of the world can learn English with these fun videos. Also, as a scriptwriter, I chose what I hope are fun topics for the whole family to talk about, from cooking and shopping to sports and music.
And which parts of the show were a lot of fun to make, or things that you thought were funny?
Andrew, great question. I really love working with creative people. So working with the man who made the videos was so much fun. I would think of crazy situations like flying in space or visiting the dinosaurs, and he would make it happen with the computer. Anything was possible. And I have to say, I really loved writing for Daisy. She was always causing trouble for me and Max.
When we first started filming the show, it was in the middle of the pandemic, so we had to figure out a way to film outside, which we did. And viewers will be able to see your treehouse, which was a really fun location to go to film. You know, talking about the show makes me want to watch it again. And listeners, even though Let's Learn English with Anna was made for children, people of all ages can enjoy it and learn from it.
Well, Anna, we'd love to speak with you longer, much longer, but a little bird is telling me we're out of time. Can you help us say goodbye, like they do in the movie The Sound of Music?
Yes, I know what song you mean, and I love it, although I don't know the whole thing. But so long, farewell, alvida, goodbye.
That was three ways to say goodbye in English and one in German just for fun. Thanks for listening to the lesson of the day on the Learning English podcast. Now it's time for all of us to say goodbye. I'm Jill Robbins.
And I'm Andrew Smith.
And I'm Anna Matteo. Are you ready, guys? 1, 2, 3. Goodbye.
Goodbye.
Oh, we can do better than that. Guys, come back. 1, 2, 3. Ready, guys? 1, 2, 3. Goodbye.
Goodbye.
That's all the time we have for today's show, but join us again tomorrow for another VOA Learning English program. Thanks for listening. I'm Caty Weaver.
And I'm Bryan Lynn.